Chapter 0 of Civilization, Its Cause and Cure, and Other Essays. Civilization, Its Cause and Cure, and Other Essays by Edward Carpenter. Preface to Complete Edition, 1920. In looking over this volume, first published in 1889, with a view to a final edition, I am glad to note that after all, there is not much in it requiring alteration. Considering that the original issue took place more than 30 years ago, I had thought that the great changes in scientific and philosophic thought which have taken place during that period would probably have rendered out of date a good deal of the book. As a matter of fact, the first paper, that on civilization, was given as a lecture before the Fabian Society in 1888, and I shall not easily forget the furious attacks which were made upon it on that occasion. The book, published as a whole in 1889, came in for a very similar reception from the press critics. They slated it to the top of their bent, except in those not unfrequent cases when they ignored it as almost beneath notice. The whole trend of the thought of the time was against its conclusions, and it is perhaps worthwhile to recall these facts in order to measure how far we have traveled in these 30 years. For today, I think we may say, these conclusions are generally admitted as correct, and the views which seemed so hazarded and precarious at the earlier date are now fairly accepted and established. The word civilization has undoubtedly, during this period, suffered an ominous change of color. It is no longer an easy term denoting all that is ideal and delightful in social life, but on the contrary, carries with it a sense of doubt and of criticism, as of something that is by no means accepted yet, but is rather on its trial, if not actually condemned. I am sorry to note, however, that the suggestion made more than once in the course of my book, namely, that the term civilization should properly be given an historical instead of ideal value, as applicable to a certain period only in the history of each people, has not yet been generally taken up. Yet, a paper by some more competent person than myself on the definite marks and signs of the civilization period in history, their first appearance in the course of human progress and evolution, and their probable disappearance again at a later stage, would be greatly interesting and instructive. My little essay on this subject was written at the time of its composition with a good deal of imaginative elan, and is, of course, open to criticism on that side, as being mainly enthusiastic in character and only slenderly supported by exact data, proofs, historical illustrations, analogies, and so forth. But to largely alter or amend the essay without seriously crippling it would be impossible, and though the form may be hurried or inadequate, yet as far as the actual contents and conclusions are concerned, I still adhere to them absolutely, and believe that time will show them to be fully justified. With regard to my views on modern science, the last quarter of a century has curiously corroborated them, for while on the one hand, as expected, the progress in actual discovery and application of observed facts has been enormous, the theories, on the other hand, about all these things have receded more and more into the background, and have passed almost out of sight. While knowing, for instance, infinitely more about electrical actions and adaptations than we did, we seem to be, if anything, further off than ever from any valid theory of what electricity is. The same with regard to heat and light, to astronomical, biological, and geological laws, and so forth. On such matters, modern science is on the verge of confessing itself bankrupt, but not wishing to do that, it keeps a discreet silence. The atom, which I ventured, to the disgust of my scientific friends, to make fun of 30 years ago, has now exploded of itself as thoroughly as a German coal box, and the fixed chemical elements of older days have of late dissolved into protean vapors and emanations, ions and electrons, impossible to follow through their endless transformations. As to the numerous laws of nature, which in the 19th century we were just about to establish for all eternity, it is only with the greatest difficulty that any of these can now be discovered, most of them having got secreted away into the darkness of ancient textbooks, where they lead forlorn and sightless existences like the fish in the caves of Kentucky. Here again, in my chapters on science, though some expressions remain which are now out of date, I have thought it best to leave them as originally written, the meanings and general conclusions being still valid and as they were. It will be seen that the general drift of these chapters is to point the moral that the true field of science is to be found in life, and that the best way to know things is to experience their meaning and to identify oneself with them through action. From a study on these principles will ultimately emerge a science truly humane and creative, masterful, and capable of building a true home for men, instead of the feverish, spectral, and self-deluding thing which has usurped the name up to now. Something the same will happen with the conception of morality. The abstract codes on this subject, which have wrought so much havoc by their fatal intrusion on the field of human life, are rapidly fading away. These ghosts, like the ghosts of nature's laws, are receiving their quietus, and the general outline which was suggested in The Defense of Criminals has now been traced more positively in the chapter on the new morality, inserted at the end of the present volume. Morality has at last to become truly human, and the real expression of our organic need. Man has to be liberated from the cramps and suppressions and fixations which have hitherto paralyzed him in the moral field. He has to emerge from the swathing bands of his pupil stage into the free air of heaven, and to become, in the highest sense, self-determining and creative. Thus, three things. 1. The realization of a new order of society in closest touch with nature, and in which the diseases of class domination and parasitism will have finally ceased. 2. The realization of a science which will no longer be a mere thing of the brain, but a part of actual life. And 3. The realization of a morality which will signalize and express the vital and organic unity of man with his fellows. These three things will become the heralds of a new era of humanity, an era which will possibly prefer not to call itself by the name of civilization. In order to corroborate and confirm the first paper in the book, an appendix has now been added containing notes and data on the life and customs of many uncivilized peoples, for much of which appendix I am indebted to the assistance of my widely read and resourceful friend E. Bertram Lloyd. E.C., December 1920. End of Chapter 0.
Section 1 of Civilization, Its Cause and Cure, and Other Essays. Civilization, Its Cause and Cure, and Other Essays, by Edward Carpenter. Section 1. The friendly and flowing savage. Who is he? Is he waiting for civilization? Or is he past it and mastering it? Whitman. We find ourselves today in the midst of a somewhat peculiar state of society, which we call civilization, but which even to the most optimistic among us does not seem altogether desirable. Some of us, indeed, are inclined to think that it is a kind of disease which the various races of man have to pass through, as children pass through measles or whooping cough. But if it is a disease, there is the serious consideration to be made that while history tells us of many nations that have been attacked by it, of many that have succumbed to it, and of some that are still in the throes of it, we know of no single case in which a nation has fairly recovered from and passed through it to a more normal and healthy condition. In other words, the development of human society has never yet, that we know of, passed beyond a certain definite and apparently final stage in the process we call civilization. At that stage, it has always succumbed or been arrested. Of course, it may at first sound extravagant to use the word disease in connection with civilization at all, but a little thought should show that the association is not ill-grounded. To take the matter on its physical side first, I find that in Mulhall's Dictionary of Statistics, 1884, the number of accredited doctors and surgeons in the United Kingdom is put at over 23,000. If the extent of the national sickness is such that we require 23,000 medical men to attend to us, it must surely be rather serious. And they do not cure us. Wherever we look today, in mansion or in slum, we see the features and hear the complaints of ill health. The difficulty is really to find a healthy person. The state of the modern civilized man in this respect, our coughs, colds, mufflers, dread of a waft of chill air, etc., is anything but credible, and it seems to be the fact that, notwithstanding all our libraries of medical science, our knowledges, arts, and appliances of life, we are actually less capable of taking care of ourselves than the animals are. Indeed, talking of animals, we are, as Shelley, I think, points out, fast depraving the domestic breeds. The cow, the horse, the sheep, and even the confiding pussycat are becoming ever more and more subject to disease, and are liable to the ills which in their wilder state they knew not of. And finally, the savage races of the earth do not escape the baneful influence. Wherever civilization touches them, they die like flies from the smallpox, drink, and worse evil it brings along with it. And often its mere contact is sufficient to destroy whole races. But the word disease is applicable to our social as well as to our physical condition. For as in the body, disease arises from the loss of the physical unity which constitutes health, and so takes the form of warfare or discord between the various parts, or of the abnormal development of individual organs, or the consumption of the system by predatory germs and growths. So in our modern life we find the unity gone which constitutes true society, and in its place warfare of classes and individuals, abnormal development of some to the detriment of others, and consumption of the organism by masses of social parasites. If the word disease is applicable anywhere, I should say it is, both in its direct and its derived sense, to the civilized societies of today. Again, mentally, is not our condition most unsatisfactory? I am not alluding to the number and importance of the lunatic asylums which cover our land, nor to the fact that maladies of the brain and nervous system are now so common, but to the strange sense of mental unrest which marks our populations and which amply justifies Ruskin's cutting epigram, that our two objects in life are, quote, whatever we have, to get more, and wherever we are, to go somewhere else, end quote. This sense of unrest, of disease, penetrates down even into the deepest regions of man's being, into his moral nature, disclosing itself there, as it has done in all nations notably at the time of their full civilization, as the sense of sin. All down the Christian centuries we find this strange sense of inward strife and discord developed, in marked contrast to the naive insouciance of the pagan and primitive world, and what is strangest, we even find people glorying in this consciousness, which, while it may be the harbinger of better things to come, is and can be in itself only the evidence of loss of unity, and therefore of ill health, in the very center of human life. Of course we are aware with regard to civilization that the word is sometimes used in a kind of ideal sense, as to indicate a state of future culture towards which we are tending, the implied assumption being that a sufficiently long course of top hats and telephones will in the end bring us to this ideal condition, while any little drawbacks in the process, such as we have just pointed out, are explained as being merely accidental and temporary. Men sometimes speak of civilizing and ennobling influences as if the two terms were interchangeable. And of course, if they like to use the word civilization in this sense, they have a right to. But whether the actual tendencies of modern life taken in the mass are ennobling, except in a quite indirect way hereafter to be dwelt upon, is, to say the least, a doubtful question. Anyone who would get an idea of the glorious being that is, as a matter of fact, being turned out by the present process should read Mr. K. Robinson's article in The 19th Century for May 1883, in which he prophesies, quite solemnly and in the name of science, that the human being of the future will be a toothless, bald, toeless creature with flaccid muscles and limbs almost incapable of locomotion. Perhaps it is safer on the whole not to use the word civilization in such ideal sense, but to limit its use, as is done today by all writers on primitive society, to a definite historical stage through which the various nations pass, and in which we can actually find ourselves at the present time. Though there is, of course, a difficulty in marking the commencement of any period of historical evolution very definitely, yet all students of this subject agree that the growth of property and the ideas and institutions flowing from it did at a certain point bring about such a change in the structure of human society that the new stage might fairly be distinguished from the earlier stages of savagery and barbarism by a separate term. The growth of wealth, it is shown, and with it the conception of private property, brought on certain very definite new forms of social life. It destroyed the ancient system of society based upon the gens, that is, a society of equals founded upon a blood relationship, and introduced a society of classes founded upon differences of material possession. It destroyed the ancient system of mother right and inheritance through the female line, and turned the woman into the property of the man. It brought with it private ownership of land, and so created a class of landless aliens and a whole system of rent, mortgage, interest, etc. It introduced slavery, serfdom, and wage labor, which are only various forms of the dominance of one class over another, and to rivet these authorities it created the state and the policeman. Every race that we know that has become what we call civilized has passed through these changes, and though the details may vary and have varied a little, the main order of change has been practically the same in all cases. We are justified, therefore, in calling civilization a historical stage, whose commencement dates roughly from the division of society into classes founded on property and the adoption of class government. Lewis Morgan, in his Ancient Society, adds that the invention of writing and the consequent adoption of written history and written law. Engels, in his Ursprung der Familie, des Privatgentums und des Staats, points out the importance of the appearance of the merchant, even in his most primitive form, as a mark of the civilization period. While the French writers of the last century made a good point in inventing the term nations policies, policemanized nations, as a substitute for civilized nations, for perhaps there is no better or more universal mark of the period we are considering and of its social degradation than the appearance of the crawling phenomenon in question. Imagine the rage of any decent North American Indians if they had been told they required policemen to keep them in order. If we take this historical definition of civilization, we shall see that our English civilization began hardly more than 1,000 years ago. And even so, the remains of the more primitive society lasted long after that. In the case of Rome, if we reckon from the later times of the early kings down to the fall of Rome, we have again about 1,000 years. The Jewish civilization from David and Solomon downwards lasted, with breaks, somewhat over 1,000 years. The Greek civilization less. The series of Egyptian civilizations, which we can now distinguish, lasted altogether very much longer, but the important points to see are, first, that the process has been quite similar in character in these various and numerous other cases, quite as similar, in fact, as the course of the same disease in various persons, and secondly, that in no case, as said before, has any nation come through and passed beyond the stage, but that in most cases it has succumbed soon after the main symptoms had been developed. But it will be said, it may be true that civilization, regarded as a stage of human history, presents some features of disease, but is there any reason for supposing that disease in some form or other was any less present in the previous stage, that of barbarism? To which I reply, I think there is good reason. Without committing ourselves to the unlikely theory that the noble savage was an ideal human being, physically or in any other respect, and while certain that in many points he was decidedly inferior to the civilized man, I think we must allow him the superiority in some directions, and one of these was his comparative freedom from disease. Lewis Morgan, who grew up among the Iroquois Indians, and who probably knew the North American natives as well as any white man has ever done, says, in his Ancient Society, page 45, quote, "Barbarism ends with the production of grand barbarians," end quote. And though there are no native races on the earth today who are actually in the latest and most advanced stage of barbarism, yet, if we take the most advanced tribes that we know of, such as the said Iroquois Indians of 20 or 30 years ago, some of the Kaffir tribes around Lake Nyasa in Africa. Now, and possibly for a few years more, comparatively untouched by civilization, or the tribes along the River Uapis 30 or 40 years back of Wallace's travels on the Amazon, all tribes in what Morgan would call the middle stage of barbarism. We undoubtedly in each case discover a fine and, which is our point here, healthy people. Captain Cook, in his first voyage, says of the natives of Otaheite, quote, "We saw no critical disease during our stay upon the island, and but few instances of sickness, which were accidental fits of the colic," end quote. And, later on, of the New Zealanders, quote, "They enjoy perfect and uninterrupted health. In all our visits to their towns, where young and old, men and women crowded about us, we never saw a single person who appeared to have any bodily complaint, nor among the numbers we have seen naked did we perceive the slightest eruption upon the skin, or any marks that an eruption had left behind," end quote. These are pretty strong words. Of course diseases exist among such peoples, even where they have never been in contact with civilization. But I think we may say that among the higher types of savages, they are rarer and nothing like so various and so prevalent as they are in our modern life. While the power of recovery from wounds, which are, of course, the most frequent form of disablement, is generally admitted to be something astonishing. Speaking of the Kaffirs, J.G. Wood says, quote, "Their state of health enables them to survive injuries which would be almost instantly fatal to any civilized European," end quote. Mr. Frank Oates, in his diary, mentions the case of a man who was condemned to death by the king. He was hacked down with axes and left for dead. Quote, "What must have been intended for the coup de grace was a cut in the back of the head, which had chipped a large piece out of the skull and must have been meant to cut the spinal cord where it joins the brain. It had, however, been made a little higher than this, but had left such a wound as I should have thought that no one could have survived. When I held the lantern to investigate the wound, I started back in amazement to see a hole at the base of the skull, perhaps 2 inches long and 1.5 inches wide, and I will not venture to say how deep, but the death too must have been an affair of inches. Of course this hole penetrated into the substance of the brain, and probably for some distance. I dare say a mouse could have sat in it," end quote. Yet the man was not so much disconcerted. Like old King Cole, he asked for a pipe and a drink of brandy, and ultimately made a perfect recovery. Of course it might be said that such a story only proves the lowness of organization of the brains of savages. But to the Kaffirs, at any rate, this would not apply. They are a quick-witted race with large brains and exceedingly acute in argument, as Colenso found to his cost. Another point which indicates superabundant health is the amazing animal spirits of these native races. The shouting, singing, dancing kept up nights long among the Kaffirs are exhausting merely to witness, while the graver North American Indian exhibits a corresponding power of life in his eagerness for battle or his stoic resistance of pain. Similarly, when we come to consider the social life of the wilder races, however rudimentary and undeveloped it may be, the almost universal testimony of students and travelers is that within its limits it is more harmonious and compact than that of the civilized nations. The members of the tribe are not organically at warfare with each other. Society is not divided into classes which prey upon each other, nor is it consumed by parasites. There is more true social unity, less of disease, though the customs of each tribe are rigid, absurd, and often frightfully cruel. And though all outsiders are liable to be regarded as enemies, yet within those limits the members live peacefully together. Their pursuits, their work, are undertaken in common. Thieving and violence are rare. Social feeling and community of interest are strong. Quote, "In their own bands, Indians are perfectly honest. In all my intercourse with them, I have heard of not over half a dozen cases of such theft. But this wonderfully exceptional honesty extends no further than to the members of his immediate band. To all outside of it, the Indian is not only one of the most arrant thieves in the world, but this quality or faculty is held in the highest estimation." End quote. Dodge, page 64. If a man set out on a journey, this among the Kaffirs, quote, "He need not trouble himself about provisions, for he is sure to fall in with some hut, or perhaps a village, and is equally sure of obtaining both food and shelter," end quote. Quote, "I have lived," says A.R. Wallace in his Malay Archipelago, Volume 2, page 460, "with communities in South America and the East, who have no laws or law courts but the public opinion of the village. Yet each man scrupulously respects the rights of his fellows, and any infraction of those rights rarely takes place. In such a community, all are nearly equal. There are none of those wide distinctions of education and ignorance, wealth and poverty, master and servant, which are the product of our civilization." End quote. Indeed, this community of life in the early societies, this absence of division into classes, and of the contrast between rich and poor, is now admitted on all sides as a marked feature of difference between the conditions of the primitive and of civilized man. Lastly, with regard to the mental condition of the barbarian, probably no one will be found to dispute the contention that he is more easy-minded and that his consciousness of sin is less developed than in his civilized brother. Our unrest is the penalty we pay for our wider life. The missionary retires, routed from the savage in whom he can awake no sense of his supreme wickedness. An American lady had a servant, a Negro woman, who on one occasion asked leave of absence for the next morning, saying she wished to attend the Holy Communion. "I have no objection," said the mistress, "to grant you leave, but do you think you ought to attend communion? You know you have never said you were sorry about that goose you stole last week." "Law, missus," replied the woman, "do you think I'd let an old goose stand betwixt me and my blessed lord and master?" But joking apart, and however necessary for man's ultimate evolution may be the temporary development of this consciousness of sin, we cannot help seeing that the condition of the mind in which it is absent is the most distinctively healthy. Nor can it be concealed that some of the greatest works of art have been produced by people like the earlier Greeks in whom it was absent, and could not possibly have been produced where it was strongly developed. Though, as already said, the latest stages of barbarism, i.e. that just preceding civilization, is unrepresented on the earth today. Yet we have in the Homeric and other dawn literature of the various nations indirect records of the stage, and these records assure us of a condition of man very similar to, though somewhat more developed than, the condition of the existing races I have mentioned above. Besides this, we have in the numerous traditions of the Golden Age, legends of the fall, etc., a curious fact which suggests to us that a great number of races, in advancing toward civilization, were conscious at some point or other of having lost a primitive condition of ease and contentment, and that they embodied this consciousness, with poetical adornment and license in imaginative legends of the earlier paradise. Some people, indeed, seeing the universality of these stories and the remarkable fragments of wisdom embedded in them, and other extremely ancient myths and writings, have supposed that there really was a general prehistoric Eden Garden or Atlantis, but the necessities of the case hardly seems to compel this supposition. That each human soul, however, bears within itself some kind of reminiscence of a more harmonious and perfect state of being, which it has at some time experienced, seems to me a conclusion difficult to avoid. And this, by itself, might give rise to manifold traditions and myths. End of section 1. Section 2 of Civilization, Its Cause and Cure, and Other Essays. Civilization, Its Cause and Cure, and Other Essays, by Edward Carpenter. Section 2. However all this may be, the question immediately before us, having established the more healthy, though more limited, condition of the pre-civilization peoples, is, why this lapse or fall? What is the meaning of this manifold and intensified manifestation of disease? Physical, social, intellectual, and moral. What is its place and part in the great whole of human evolution? And this involves us in a digression, which must occupy a few pages, on the nature of health. When we come to analyze the conception of disease, physical or mental, in society or in the individual, it evidently means, as already hinted once or twice, loss of unity. Health, therefore, should mean unity. And it is curious that the history of the word entirely corroborates this idea. As is well known, the words health, whole, holy are from the same stock, and they indicate to us the fact that far back in the past, those who created this group of words had a conception of the meaning of health very different from ours, and which they embodied unconsciously in the word itself and its strange relatives. These are, for instance, and among others, heal, hollow, hail, holy, whole, wholesome, German heilig, Highland, the Savior, Latin salus, as in salutation, salvation, Greek kalos, also compare hail, a salutation, and, less certainly connected, the root hal, to breathe, as in inhale, exhale, French haleine, Italian and French alma and ame, the soul, compare the Latin spiritus, spirit or breath, and Sanskrit atman, breath or soul. Wholeness, holiness, if thine eye be single, thy whole body shall be full of light. Thy faith hath made thee whole. The idea seems to be a positive one, a condition of the body in which it is an entirety, a unity, a central force maintaining that condition, and disease being the breakup or breakdown of that entirety into multiplicity. The peculiarity about our modern conception of health is that it seems to be a purely negative one. So impressed are we by the myriad presence of disease, so numerous its dangers, so sudden and unforetellable its attacks, that we have come to look upon health as the mere absence of the same. As a solitary spy picks his way through a hostile camp at night, sees the enemy sitting around his fires, and trembles at the crackling of a twig beneath his feet, so the traveler through this world, comforter in one hand and physic bottle in the other, must pick his way, fearful lest at any time he disturb the sleeping legions of death. Thrice blessed if by any means, steering now to the right and now to the left, and thinking only of his personal safety, he passed by without discovery to the other side. Health with us is a negative thing. It is a neutralization of opposing dangers. It is to be neither rheumatic nor gouty, consumptive nor bilious, to be untroubled by headache, backache, heartache, or any of the thousand natural shocks that flesh is heir to. These are the realities. Health is the mere negation of them. The modern notion, and which has evidently in a very subtle way penetrated the whole thought of today, is that the essential fact of life is the existence of innumerable external forces, which, by a very delicate balance and difficult to maintain, concur to produce man, who in consequence may at any moment be destroyed again by the non-concurrence of those forces. The older notion, apparently, is that the essential fact of life is man himself, and that the external forces, so-called, are in some ways subsidiary to this fact, that they may aid his expression or manifestation, or that they may hinder it, but that they can neither create nor annihilate the man. Probably both ways of looking at this subject are important. There is a man that can be destroyed, and there is a man that cannot be destroyed. The old words, soul and body, indicate this contrast, but like all words, they are subject to the defeat, and they are an attempt to draw a line where no line can ultimately be drawn. They mark a contrast where, in fact, there is only continuity, where between the little mortal man who dwells here and now, and the divine and universal man, who also forms a part of our consciousness, is there not a perfect gradation of being? And where, if anywhere, is there a gulf fixed? Together they form a unit, and each is necessary to the other. The first cannot do without the second, and the second cannot get along at all without the first. To use the words of Angelus Silesius, quoted by Schopenhauer, Ich weiß, dass ohne mich Gott nicht ein nur kann leben. According then to the elder conception, and perhaps according to an elder experience, man, to be really healthy, must be a unit, an entirety. His more external and momentary self-standing in some kind of filial relation to his more universal and incorruptible part, so that not only the remotest and outermost regions of the body and all the assimilative, secretive, and other processes belonging thereto, but even the thoughts and passions of the mind itself, stand in direct and clear relationship to it. The final and absolute transparency of the mortal creature, and thus this divinity in each creature, being that which constitutes it and cause it to cohere together, was conceived of as that creature's savior, healer. Healer of wounds of body and wounds of heart, the man within the man, whom it was not only possible to know, but whom to know and be united with was the alone salvation. This, I take it, was a law of health and of holiness, as accepted at some elder time of human history, and by a seen as through a glass darkly, and the condition of disease and of sin under the same view was the reverse of this, enfeeblement, obscuration, duplicity, the central radiation blocked, lesser and insubordinate centers establishing and asserting themselves as against it, division, discord, possession by devils. Thus in the body, the establishment of an insubordinate center, a boil, a tumor, the introduction and spread of a germ with innumerable progeny throughout the system, the enlargement out of all reason of an existing organ, means disease. In the mind, disease begins when any passion asserts itself as an independent center of thought and action. The condition of health in the mind is loyalty to the divine man within it. But if loyalty to money become an independent center of life, or greed of knowledge, or of fame, or of drink, jealousy, lust, the love of approbation, or mere following after any so-called virtue for itself, purity, humility, consistency, or what not, these may grow to seriously endanger the other. They are, or should be, subordinates. And though over a long period their insubordination may be a necessary condition of human progress, yet during all such time they are at war with each other and with the central will. The man is torn and tormented, and is not happy. And when I speak thus separately of the mind and body, it must be remembered, as already said, that there is no strict line between them, but probably every affection of passion of the mind has its correlative in the condition of the body, though this later may or may not be easily observable. Gluttony is a fever of the digestive apparatus. What is a taint in the mind is also a taint in the body. The stomach has started the original idea of becoming itself the center of the human system. The sexual organs may start a similar idea. Here are distinct threats, menaces made against the central authority, against the man himself. For the man must rule or disappear. It is impossible to imagine a man presided over by a stomach, a walking stomach, using hands, feet, and all other members merely to carry it from place to place, and serve its assimilative mania. We call such a one an hog, and thus, in the theory of evolution, we see the place of the hog and all other animals, as forerunners or offshoots of special faculties in man, and why the true man, and rightly, has authority over all animals, and can alone give them their place in creation. So of the brain, or any other organ, for the man is no organ, resides in no organ, but is the essential life ruling and radiating among all organs, and assigning them their arts to play. Disease, then, in body or mind, is from this point of view the breakup of its unity, its entirety, into multiplicity. It is the abeyance of a central power, and the growth of insubordinate centers. Life in each creature, being conceived of as a continual exercise of energy or conquest, by which external or antagonistic forces and organisms are brought into subjection and compelled into the service of the creature, or are thrown off as harmful to it. Thus, by way of illustration, we find that plants or animals, when in good health, have a remarkable power of throwing off the attacks of any parasites which incline to infest them, while those that are weakly or very soon eaten up by the same, a rose tree, for instance, brought indoors, will soon fall a prey to the aphis, though when hardened out of doors, the pest makes next to no impression on it. In dry seasons, when the young turnip plants in the fields are weakly from want of water, the entire crop is sometimes destroyed by the turnip fly, which then multiplies enormously. But if a shower or two of rain come before much damage is done, the plant will then grow vigorously. Its tissues become more robust and resist the attacks of the fly, which in its turn dies. Late investigations seem to show that one of the functions of the white corpuscles in the blood is to devour disease, germs and bacteria present in the circulation. Thus absorbing these organisms into subjection to the central life of the body, and that with this object they congregate in numbers toward any part of the body which is wounded or diseased. Or, to take an example from society, it is clear enough that if our social life were really vivid and healthy, such parasitic products as the idle shareholder and the policeman above mentioned would simply be impossible. The material on which they prey would not exist, and they would either perish or be transmuted into useful forms. It seems obvious, in fact, that life in any organism can only be maintained by some such process as these, by which parasitic or infesting organisms are either thrown off or absorbed into subjection. To define the nature of the power which thus works towards and creates the distinctive unity of each organism may be difficult, is probably at present impossible, but that some such power exists we can hardly refuse to admit. Probably it is more of a subject of the growth of our consciousness than an object of external scientific investigation. In this view, death is simply the loosening and termination of the action of this power over certain regions of the organism, a process by which, when these superficial parts become hardened and osseous, as in old age or irreparably damaged, as in cases of accident, the inward being sloughs them off and passes into other spheres. In the case of man, there may be noble and there may be ignoble death, as there may be noble and ignoble life. The inward self, unable to maintain authority over the forces committed to its charge, declining from its high prerogative, swarmed over by parasites and fallen partially into the clutch of obscene foes, may at last with shame and torment be driven forth from the temple in which it ought to have been supreme. Or, having fulfilled a holy and wholesome time, having radiated divine life and love through all the channels of body and mind, and as a perfect workman uses his tools, so having with perfect mastery and nonchalance used all the materials committed to it, it may quietly and peacefully lay these down, and unchanged, absolutely unchanged to all but material eyes, pass on to other spheres appointed. And now a few words on the medical aspect of the subject. If we accept any theory, even remotely similar to that just indicated, to the effect that health is a positive thing, not a mere negation of disease, it becomes pretty clear that no mere investigation of the latter will enable us to find out what the former is, or bring us nearer to it. You might as well try to create the ebb and flow of the tides by an organized system of mops. Turn your back upon the sun, and go forth into the wilderness of space till you come to those limits where the rays of light, faint with distance, fall dim upon the confines of eternal darkness. And phantoms and shadows in the half-light are the product of the wavering conflict betwixt day and night. Investigate these shadows, describe them, classify them, record the changes which take place in them. Erect in vast libraries these records into a monument of human industry and research. So shall you be at the end as near to a knowledge and understanding of the sun itself, which all this time you have left behind you, and on which you have turned your back, as the investigators of disease are to a knowledge and understanding of what health is. The solar rays illumine the outer world and give it to its unity and entirety. So in the inner world of each individual, possibly, is there another sun, which illumines and gives unity to the man, and whose warmth and light would permeate his system. Wait upon the shining forth of this inward sun, give free access and welcome to its rays of love, and free passage for them into the common world around you, and it may be you will get to know more about health than all the books of medicine contain or can tell you. Or to take the former simile, it is the central force of the moon which, acting on the great ocean, makes all its waters one, and causes them to rise and fall in timely consent. But take your moon away, hey, now the tide is flowing too far down this estuary. Station your thousands with mops, but it breaks through in channel and runlet. Block it here, but it overflows in a neighboring bay. Appoint an army of swabs there, but to what end? The infinitest care along the fringe of this great sea can never do, with all imaginable dirt and confusion, what the central power does easily, and with unerring grace and providence. And so of the great, the vast and wonderful ocean, which ebbs and flows within a man, take away the central guide, and not 20,000 doctors, each with 20,000 books to consult, and 20,000 files of different contents to administer, could meet the myriad cases of disease which would ensue, or bolster up into wholeness the being from whom the single radiant unity had departed. Probably there has never been an age nor any country, except Yankee Land, in which disease has been so generally prevalent as in England today. And certainly there has never, with the same exception, been an age or country in which doctors have so swarmed, or in which medical science has been so powerful in apparatus, in learning, in authority, and in actual organization and number of adherents. How reconcile this contradiction, if indeed a contradiction it be? But the fact is that medical science does not contradict disease, any more than laws abolish crime. Medical science, and doubtless for very good reasons, makes a fetish of disease and dances around it. It is, as a rule, only seen where disease is. It writes enormous tomes on disease. It induces disease in animals and even men for the purpose of studying it. It knows, to a marvelous extent, the symptoms of disease, its nature, its causes, its goings out and its comings in. Its eyes are perpetually fixed on disease, till disease, for it, becomes the main fact of the world and the main object of its worship. Even what it is so gracefully called hygiene does not get beyond this negative attitude, and the world still waits for its healer, who shall tell us, diseased and suffering as we are, what health is, where it is to be found, whence it flows, and who, having touched this wonderful power within himself, shall not rest till he has proclaimed and imparted it to men. No, medical science does not, in the main, contradict disease. The same cause, infidelity and decay of the central life in men, which creates disease and makes men liable to it, creates students and a science of the subject. The moon having gone from over the waters, the good people rush forth with their mops, and the untimely inundations, and the mops, and the mess, and the pother, are all due to the same cause. As to the lodgment of disease, it is clear that this would take place easily in a disorganized system, just as a seditious adventurer would easily effect a landing, and would find insubordinate materials ready at hand for his use, in a land where the central government was weak. And as to the treatment of a disease, so introduced there are obviously two methods. One is to reinforce the central power till it is sufficiently strong of itself to eject the insubordinate elements and restore order. The other is to attack the malady from outside and, if possible, destroy it, as by doses and decoctions, independently of the inner vitality and leaving that as it was before. The first method would seem the best, most durable and effective, but it is difficult and slow. It consists in the adoption of a healthy life, bodily and mental, and will be spoken of later on. The second may be characterized as the medical method, and is valuable, or rather, I should be inclined to say, will be valuable when it has found its place, which is to be subsidiary to the first. It is too often, however, regarded as superior in importance, and in this way, though easy of application, has come perhaps to be productive of more harm than good. The disease may be broken down for the time being, but the roots of it not being destroyed, it soon springs up again in the same or a new form, and the patient is as badly off as ever. The great positive force of health, and the power which it has to expel disease from its neighborhood is a thing realized, I believe, by few persons. But it has been realized on Earth, and will be realized again when the more squalid elements of our present-day civilization have passed away. End of section 2. Section 3 of Civilization, Its Cause and Cure, and Other Essays. Civilization, Its Cause and Cure, and Other Essays, by Edward Carpenter. Section 3. The result, then, of our digression is to show that health, in body or mind, means unity, integration as opposed to disintegration. In the animals we find this physical unity, existing to a remarkable degree. An almost unerring instinct and selective power rules their actions and organization. Thus a cat, before it has fallen, say before it has become a very wheezy fireside pussy, is in a sense perfect. The wonderful consent of its limbs as it runs or leaps, the adaptation of its muscles, the exactness and inevitableness of its instincts, physical and affectional, its senses of sight and smell, its cleanliness, nicety as to food, motherly tact, the expression of its whole body when enraged or when watching for prey, All these things are, so to speak, absolute and instantaneous, and fill one with admiration. The creature is whole, or in one piece, there is no mentionable conflict or division within it. Similarly, with the other animals, and even with the early man himself. And so it would appear, returning to our subject, that, if we accept the doctrine of evolution, there is a progression of animated beings, which, though not perfect, possess in the main the attribute of health, from the lowest forms up to a healthy and instinctive, though certainly limited, man. During all this stage, the central law is in the ascendant, and the physical frame of each creature is the fairly clean vehicle of its expression, varying, of course, in complexity and degree according to the point of unfoldment which has been reached. And when thus, in the long process of development, the inner man, which has lain hidden or dormant within the animal, at last appears, and the creature consequently takes on the outer frame and faculties of the human being, which are only as they are because of the inner man which they represent. When it has passed through stage after stage of animal life, throwing out tentative types and likenesses of what is to come, and going through innumerable preliminary exercises in special forms and faculties, till at last it begins to be able to wear the full majesty of manhood itself, then it would seem that that long process of development is drawing to a close, and that the goal of creation must be within measurable distance. But then, at that very moment, and when the goal is, so to speak, in sight, occurs this failure of wholeness of which we have spoken, this partial breakup of the unity of human nature. And man, instead of going forward any longer in the same line as before, to all appearance falls. What is the meaning of this loss of unity? What is the cause and purpose of this fall and centuries-long exile from the earlier paradise? There can be but one answer. It is self-knowledge, which involves, in a sense, the abandonment of the self. Man has to become conscious of his destiny, to lay hold of and realize his own freedom and blessedness, to transfer his consciousness from the outer and mortal part of him to the inner and undying. The cat cannot do this. Though perfect in its degree, its interior unfoldment is yet incomplete. The human soul within it has not yet come forward and declared itself. Some sheathing leaves have yet to open before the divine flower bud can be clearly seen. And when at last, speaking as a fool, the cat becomes a man, and the human soul within the creature has climbed itself forward and found expression, transforming the outer frame in the process into that of humanity, which is the meaning, I suppose, of the evolution theory, then the creature, though perfect and radiant in the form of man, still lacks one thing. It lacks the knowledge of itself. It lacks its own identity, and the realization of the manhood to which, as a fact, it has attained. In the animal's consciousness has never returned upon itself. It radiates easily outwards, and the creature obeys without let or hesitation, and with little, if any, self-consciousness, the law of its being. And when man first appears on the earth, and even up to the threshold of what we call civilization, there is much to show that he should in this respect still be classed with the animals, though vastly superior to them in attainments, physical and mental, in power over nature, capacity of progress and adaptability, he still in these earlier stages was like an animal in the unconscious instinctive nature of his action. And on the other hand, though his moral and intellectual structures were far less complete than those of the modern man, as was a necessary result of the absence of self-knowledge, he actually lived more in harmony with himself and with nature than does his descendant. His impulses, both physical and social, were clearer and more unhesitating, and his unconsciousness of inner discord and sin a great contrast to our modern condition of everlasting strife and perplexity. If then to this stage belongs some degree of human perfection and felicity, yet there remains a much vaster height to be scaled. The human soul, which has wandered darkling for so many thousands of years, from its tiny spark-like germ in some low form of life to its full splendor and dignity in man, has yet to come to the knowledge of its wonderful heritage.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.